So we'll go ahead and get started. And I don't think Don Trump's coming today. So everything's okay. Let me give you a quick background, and I mean really quick, like 30 to 60 seconds about what we're going to discuss as peers working in the field of higher ed, right? So my whole life, starting from the age of zero to, I'll let you guess at my age right now, has been nothing but a human being who loves to learn new stuff. So for example, I was a military brat. So unlike the traditional student, I went to 21 schools in 18 years. So as a teacher, you might find that challenging. To me, it was extremely useful because it did something. It was able to change the way I think in a way that most students don't benefit from. So that's part of what we'll talk about today. This particular content that we're going to talk about today took me from 8 o'clock in the morning to 3 o'clock in the afternoon to go through yesterday with a group of cognitive scientists from MIT, Harvard, and Tufts up in Cambridge. And that was a very interesting conversation, because when you walk into an expert space and tell them that the traditional theories that they've acquired aren't a reflection of what happens in the real world, cognitive dissonance sets in at a level that's just almost disconcerting. But I did move the axis of the planet just a little bit. Now, how did I sneak in here? Because I currently work full-time in the intelligence community, so I'm one of those guys that Don Trump hates, right? We don't need an IC, we don't need a DNI, we don't need an ODNI, we don't need people to do the kind of work I do. So I find all kinds of interesting ways to get into venues that normally would never let a person like me in. Okay, so we agree that I come as a friend, not a foe. On a day-to-day basis, I teach and help and code. So I have two parts of my brain, a PhD in cognitive science and advanced degrees in computer science. Normally, you don't find those in the same brain. But in our field, it's absolutely required that these two fields are merging into something called the learning sciences, which is very, very, very new. And I like to carry artifacts with me. So real quick, the best I've seen out there that speaks to some of the it's awesome, and we'll talk about it. It was the preeminent reference, other than Larkin and Simons, why a diagram is sometimes worth 10,000 words, which was core. Now, this was 2007, coming out of Carnegie Mellon. They do a great job up there, but they made one critical flawed assumption, that you cannot see what the student is thinking in their unconscious mind. Right? That's an assumption that we've just taken for granted in this field for years and years and years. It's flawed, and I'll tell you how that happens. Better yet, I'll show you how it happens. So, I don't know why you guys showed up at this, because diagrams, triangles, squares, and circles? Come on, are you kidding? You must think I'm selling crayons, right? Well, I can go anywhere in the world, and I have, with nothing more than a bag of crayons, And I do this because I can buy these anywhere, and they're cheap, so I don't have to worry about high tech in a classroom setting, or a professional setting, or the West Wing of the White House, or inside a classified facility. I can get these into a skiff, right? So anytime some of my peers see me coming, they go, oh no, are you bringing crayons again? Even they don't like to be cognitively set off these. And white paper. And traditionally, I try to use, like I did yesterday, I walked in to this facility and I said, hey, you got a printer around? And this is their printer paper. So that's all you need, right? Cheap. And this is what I did in my dissertation research, but let me tell you how this works. On your first day of class, you can do this. It's that simple. You walk in with these two things. Let's take, what was the topic of the last speaker that was here? Was it Chinese history or something? Yeah. It was history, right? Okay, so if I'm teaching that course, hi, my name's Professor Conroy, and we're going to be talking about Chinese history this semester. But first, I'm going to give you a little diagram exercise. I want you to answer three questions. And the response to each question is for you to draw triangles, squares, and circles. Nah, no labels, no annotations, no text, no numbers, no cheating, just abstract diagrams. And those diagrams have to be composed of triangles, squares, and circles, but I don't care what kind of crayons you use. Fair enough? Cool. And they're like, wow, I can do this. It doesn't matter whether they're fifth graders or 50-year-old executives in the intelligence community. Everybody can draw, right? And I'm not asking them to sketch, because people don't like to sketch. No, I'm not a good artist. I'm talking about stuff you learn at the age of four, scribbling. But those are the rules. So then I ask them three questions. So let's take Chinese history. How do you think Chinese history works? How do you store information about Chinese history in memory? Third question, how do you monitor your own learning about changes related to Chinese history? So if you notice the pattern is the questions are the same, the topic changes. So the general research question in my dissertation, the nice part about going back to get a PhD over the age of 50 is nobody can smoke you, right? You've lived too long to have anybody on your committee call foul, especially when you've got a really good research question. My research question was really simple. How can you engage prior knowledge in the classroom? Well, you know how what it's like walking into a classroom. And I teach both at the undergrad and the graduate level in four different universities. So I make sure that I go to the zoo and see a lot of different animals. And in every case, these diagrams come back looking exactly the same. I can't tell the difference between diagrams from undergrads, grads, AU, GW, Virginia Tech, Hopkins. So what's going on there? What I'm trying to show to them in the first hour of that class is, hey, you guys thought that you came in with a fairly coherent view of how Chinese history works, 101 economics works. I teach in the iTech curriculum over at COGOD. They don't like me because I'm a little bit disruptive, but that's okay, right? Because I'm actually a computer scientist teaching my topic in a business school. They find that a little disconcerting, but that's okay. A lot of people do. Just like computer scientists don't like to talk about cognitive science. Oh no, Art, you can't see inside the brain, especially with computers. It's not going to happen. So what ends up happening is I get these diagrams back and then I hold them up for the students. And I go, guys, what are we doing here? I thought you guys all had prior knowledge coming into the class about information technology, but guess what? You actually don't, because you've proven to me that your diagrams across all three questions are all different. That got me an invitation to speak at TED. That was really fun. But I had to obfuscate some of the background when I gave the TED talk because of the community that I work in. This venue is a little bit different. I can be a little bit more open here at AU. Because Alan promised me he's going to block out sections with a black marker that aren't politically correct or sensitive to our national security. So truly, so that's the experience, right? Can you imagine how simple that is? In our field, and they made the case in this book appropriately, but then they totally limited it that, hey, prior knowledge is important, right? If I have students coming into my class, let me put it a different way. If somebody climbs into my cockpit and they say, hey, I just graduated from flight school, and I'm going to go, oh my gosh, I hope you understand drag, lift, acceleration, angle of attack. If you don't, I'm in deep trouble because you and I are flying assault helicopters north of Korea. That's dangerous. I take the same approach in class. Even if you're coming into an iTech 200 class, guys, tell me what you know about technology. Okay? But I don't want you to write anything down. I want you to draw diagrams for me. So, guess what? That's it. That's the end of my sales pitch. Right? Simple enough. So now let's get into, so that kind of narrative we just had is good for professionals outside our field. But you're professionals. You teach every day. you have students that want to learn every day. So now we're going to deep dive into the science, and hopefully in a very short time, because I'm expecting, although we've agreed it might not go off, I want to leave you at least with enough artifacts that you can walk out of here and go, you know, I get what Art's saying. And guess what? I'm not here to sell you anything. I don't want you to go to my website. I don't do Facebook. You know, I'm not doing click-throughs, none of that. That's not important. What's important is that our community, that is the community of roughly 3 million learning and teaching professionals in the U.S., figure out how to reboot education. I'm not the guy you want to invite into your department lunch and learn, because people are going to get really upset at some of the things I say, but that's okay. We'll get over that as a community in the next couple of years. So, by the way, I don't like this sage on the stage stuff, so let me see if this works from back here. No, see, line of sight, I knew better. Ah, so this is a rendition of what we just talked about. Simple. You may have, in the research you did, heard about protocols like think aloud, speak aloud, talk aloud. That's great. Those are linguistic protocols. I had the luxury of doing research in my PhD for 5 years. They wanted to kick me out, and I said, no, I'm not ready yet. I still got more to do. Remember, I'm interdisciplinary, so I have to go deep dive into anthropology, computer science, cognitive science, educational psychology, the visual sciences, the learning sciences. It's a long road. But they were very patient with me at Virginia Tech. They said, okay, Art, we believe you. So when I could not find a protocol for me to dig inside the unconscious mind of a student, then I had to create it. So that's what this is. Don't Google draw aloud and find all this research on it, because I was the guy that wrote the protocol, and that was less than a year ago. But I'll tell you why there are reasons for not making a protocol like that publicly available yet, and we'll get to that in a minute. So, three sheets of paper, triangles, squares, and circles. Those are the rules. And again, you get back crazy diagrams. But they're valid. They're all valid. Absolutely. There's some place that I post these up, and you can always, if you need them on your iPhone as you're going down to lunch, I can email you the link.
Thank you.
So, what's going on here? After you do that exercise, oh, by the way, just so you know, I can walk into any of your departments. I can sit with the dean of any staff in this school, run this exercise, and their diagrams are going to look no better than fifth graders. And to their credit, they think they know how COGOD works, or they think they know how SIS works, but truly at a cognitive science level, we're a species that's still evolving. And many things are outpacing our ability to acquire how information is presented to us in this new world order. But you can imagine, if I'm working with a group in the intelligence community and their job is to track bad guys in Syria, if each of those analysts has an idea of how tracking Syrian bad guys appears in their view of the world, this is what we get, chaos. So this is current state. And then there's another protocol that takes you from current state to the ideal future state. And again, remember, I get to cheat because I'm not just a cognitive scientist, I'm a coder. So I'm a computer scientist. So I write code that does this stuff. So I can hold people to task. It's like, hey, show me the big data, right? Show me the data science behind this. Show me the analytics. What are the structures underlying Tableau or Excel or Access that are generating the concepts you expect to see? So I owe you this today, and I'll make sure I'll do that. That's our contract here. Informal, but you're spending time here. I want to make sure that you walk away with some consumable information that'll be useful for you. This is also a picture of my PhD. Now, the committee understands this. It's been a year since I've been out. But think about it. If I'm doing a PhD where the key artifact of my research is a work done in 1987 by Simon and Larkin, the most cited cognitive science paper in the history of cognitive science. And the title of that paper is Why a Diagram is Sometimes Worth 10,000 Words. Well, look what it just did. It collapsed a 400-page dissertation to less than 100, because guess what? I'm using diagrams. Every diagram in my dissertation was powerful enough to communicate books of information that are out there over a period of 30 years. So the committee said to me, you know, Art, some of the stuff you're writing about is so far above our head, but the bottom line is this is one of the best bibliographies we've ever seen. You have identified a gap in the research that is so wide we could drive an Amtrak train through it from here to Boston, and they were right. But again, it takes an old salt like me to go, I don't believe what is currently being told us about how students learn. So, prior knowledge, number one, is key because that's what we store in long-term memory. Abstract diagrams, number two, are key is because that's how you get into the unconscious mind of anyone, but especially students, because our business is the business of accessing that unconscious information, bringing it to the surface, and then making it better. Number three, all they say in Simon and Larkin is that, look, guys, diagrams are much better at communicating information than text. And it's only a 32-page paper. But I find PhDs across the landscape unable to engage with what Larkin and Simon were saying in that paper because they're just not patient. It took me 10 read-throughs just to begin to extract the concept. Now remember, they were both brilliant. I think Jill's still alive. Simon passed on in 2001, but he was a Nobel Prize laureate. The man's brain was amazing. He was the original... He was the original, period. If you want to learn anything about how the human animal has evolved over the last 250 million years, you have to be patient with what he was trying to tell us back then. But his writings go back to 1950. I mean, he was truly... You would think he would have gotten a PhD, I mean, a Nobel laureate in learning? No, he got in economics, of all things. Trump could learn a thing or two from. And then the last thing here is something that's very, very new, is that we now have technology to actually introspect or see what the brain is doing when it's generating these keyword topologies. And a topology sounds like it's really complicated, and it's not. A topology is a subdiscipline of mathematics. It's related to geometry, but it simply says, hey, you can represent information in a two-dimensional space using a node and an edge. That's it. You might know these as concept maps, network models. So one of the things I did about 6 months ago, and I point this out because in our field it's really important. It seems like everybody that wants to do something good these days has to have a profit model behind it. Good or bad, that's the nature of where we are today. Everybody wants to be a millionaire. But to their credit, ACUE is an organization up and based in Manhattan, and their charter is to teach college professors how to teach better. Right? That's they go to their website, and what they do, the way they make money, is to come to AU and say, hey, you've got 300 professors. We'd like to give the material to each professor on a per-seat basis, but we can't do that. We're funded by VC, so we really need to show that we're all going to eventually live out in the Hamptons in our $3 million. So the whole university has to buy this. Now, if that were a valid business model that delivered some outcomes I would agree with, we could go there, but they don't. They cite this text as probably the best effort that they've got describing learning. And as I pointed out in this book right here, and I loved their work because I was excited, right? Prior knowledge, oh my God, somebody knows how important prior knowledge is. No. However, because this process of learning takes place in the mind, we can only infer that was where they should have been locked up and served 20 years in the federal penitentiary. Because right now these are experts telling us we cannot infer the prior knowledge of a student coming into our classroom the very first day, and I've just made the case that you can through simple diagrams, right? If somebody's drawing a diagram of physics, and I've got a ball here and gravity up here and motion over here and things are moving in all kinds of different ways, I know that student's concept of how gravity works is not exactly right. So the only place we've ever used diagrams successfully is in physics 101, and this goes back to 94. So we'll talk about that briefly. But this is why you and I have to be detectives in this field. Experts are always telling us, the professionals in the classroom, how we should teach. And yet I want to give them the benefit of the doubt and say, hey, okay, show me the science behind what you're trying to prove. But first of all, I need to engage with prior knowledge. That's this bag of stuff that an 18-year-old, 19-year-old, 40-year-old brings to my classroom. I need to quickly figure out what that is. I can't sit there and go, okay, we're going to take a 3-hour test. I want to hear about your prior knowledge. And if you pass it, you can continue with the class. That's never going to work. So let's go through this real quick. My favorite guy. Why is this related to what we've talked about so far? So you know, as a good researcher, I turn over every pebble. So one of the pieces of research that was done in 1999 by the National Academies was this, how people learn. I thought I'd hit the mother load. Oh, great, here's the best scientist in the world going to tell me, an instructor, how I could learn to teach better. And all they said at the end of this was, well, you know, we can tell you three things. The student comes to the classroom with a pre-existing understanding of how the real world works. They also somehow store that in long-term memory, and we can't see that. And most students don't even know how to spell metacognition. So guess what? This was the foundation of the three questions in the protocol, right? How does the real world work? How do you store that in memory? How do you monitor your own learning? Now, because I'm a computer guy, we do something called ETL, or extract transform load. We write a lot of code. 60% of the code we write in data science is just doing data wrangling. Take it from the source, it might be an Excel spreadsheet, munge it, do transformations, get it into a harmonized format that then we can stuff into an Access database. That's ETL. So if you think about it, that's what your brain, that's what my brain, that's what my students' brain do all day long. Remember, I proved it to you. The students draw three different diagrams. And I have that kind of conversation with the students. Wait a minute. You're telling me this is how you think the real world works. Well, why in the world would you store it like that in memory? I mean, that's a lot of transformation, right? Your conceptual space has three different unconscious diagrams. So guaranteed, when you wake up in the morning, the 18 hours that you're awake is a real struggle because there's an underlying evolutionary set of concepts that guide how we navigate life as human beings on this planet. So again, I told you, I get into places that normally people don't let me in. So I was very quiet, knocked on the door. Hello, National Academies, how people learn too. Could you share with me a little bit about what version 2 is going to look like? And it's due out any day now. Any day now, they're going to publish. So 99, 2015, they've had 15 years to kind of get it right. And then I looked at the research agenda, I looked at the abstracts that were going to be published, and they totally ignored. They didn't even read or eat their own dog food from 15 years ago. This is the frustrating part about being a teacher in today's real world. And it doesn't matter whether you teach fifth grade, undergrad, graduate school, law school, have a cadre of PhD students that you're responsible for, our ability to understand how the brain learns and the investment in that process has been very, very limited. So I'm a grounded theory guy. I didn't believe any of this, so I said, you know what? I'm going to go out and investigate every screw up there is available to me to make. So what did I do? I listed in the Marine Corps. I'd definitely get killed in the Marine Corps, right? So if I didn't get killed, I'd come out with a much better idea of how the real world worked. More importantly, I ended up hanging out with these guys that crashed in the desert, 1980. Something very simple like learning how to fly with night vision goggles can have enormous impacts for the planet going forward for the next 30 years. But that was the world I lived in. Flew these kind of helicopters too. Remember, I said there's two of us in the cockpit, and there's a crew of three. And if we don't generate a common mental model, hey, why are you going right? I don't know. I'm going left. Where? You're going straight. I'm going up. That's the amazing thing about a helicopter. Unlike a fixed wing, the mechanics and physics of a helicopter force your brain to think about flying in six different dimensions, not like an elevator at US Air. Let's take off, go to Boston, back down. That's very linear thinking. The way a helicopter pilot thinks is diametrically different than the way a fixed wing pilot thinks. So this is our daily experience. This is what you're all experiencing here. Hey, what do you have in mind? Art, what do you have in mind? I don't know, what do you have in mind? To get that out in diagrams so that you quickly communicate, oh, I can see where the difference are, is critical to our field. So like I said, it took me a while to figure out how this game works. So when I got out of GW in 1980, I walked into the Marine Corps. It took me 5 years to figure out how not to kill myself. And I said, wow, this is dangerous. The system's not going to change. So then I spent the next 5 years learning about software as a software development specialist. So that takes us up to 1990. Then I realized I had to go back and get an advanced degree in computer science, so I got to hang out in the beautiful town of Boulder, Colorado. Talk about nirvana. I had a free Cray mainframe, Linux machines available to me, and NCAR in the University of Boulder, when none of that technology was available to the rest of us. In fact, I saw one of the first IP, hey, are you there on the internet? Absolutely amazing. So it took a while, folks. It took a while. Good research takes a while. I eventually ended up, my team was in Tower 2. I was working for Morgan Stanley, 9/11, getting ready to propose a new high-frequency trading platform at a time when you couldn't say high-frequency trading, and boom, Tower 1 is hit. And Rick Rascolo was the chief of police for Morgan Stanley. He got every employee of Morgan Stanley in mid-Tower 2 out, 2,300 employees. He was also the only person that had prior knowledge of the earlier bombing in the basement, 6, 7 years earlier. So he knew they were coming back. He had extreme understanding and valued prior knowledge and lessons learned. So we come to the classroom with pre-existing concepts of how I'm supposed to learn. And somehow I have that information stored in memory for quick retrieval. And then although I, as a student, have never been taught, unless you take an ed psych course, what metacognition is and how it should work, I don't even bother learning about how to detect change in my own learning. These are some of the problems that truly cause us deep, deep consternation in teaching. So over a period of another 5 years in, working across disciplines, I had to deal with models are cultural, they're evolutionary, they're anthropological, they're neurological. We try to code them in software using diagrams like this. Cognition is certainly social. That's what's intriguing about doing this kind of research in a social network environment. Don Trump loves Twitter. He's a master of using social media to our deficit. So, of course, both of my daughters are millennials. Dad, you don't know what you're talking about. I know how the world works and you don't. But these are all the facets that these young people have to deal with. I watch it in my COGOD students. You know, I'm lucky if 30% of their engagement is related to things we're doing in class, because I know they're also navigating six different apps and stuff on their laptop. And I'm not going to be the person to say, you know, shut that stuff off. I let them learn through their own mistakes what they're missing. I'm not there. Their mom and dad are somewhere back in Syracuse. That's not why I'm there. So I got to work on some very high-profile cases doing this kind of work of going back in and asking questions like, well, do we have any idea where Osama bin Laden would be hiding? Where do you think people that know that information store that in memory? How can we build systems to detect and censor the new information that would give us breadcrumbs? It's very useful. Key slide then. some of the research, when, and because I'm a software guy, I get to write software that analyzes these diagrams. I've got thousands of these diagrams over 5 years. So I just throw them into a bucket, and then I write graph analytics against them. And what came out of that extraction was, wow, there are some common facets underlying the unconscious learning of students. And they appear in what is called a directed graph, a network model, a graph model. So really, students carry around this hidden graph model of learning that they don't know exists. You and I don't know exists, but now I've told you, right? You own that information, you can't blame me. There is a hidden graph model inside the neural net of the brain that is used to process information, but we've never trained it how to process information correctly. That is one of the challenges for our field in the next 5 years, to be able to talk across these disciplines so that all kinds of departments can use this science to make learning and teaching better. Nope. I encourage you to go and see this video. It's only about 2 minutes, but it's what happened on the Hudson. So Sully was the first brain we ever have documented proof of showing how he went through this sequence of events. And what is that sequence of events? It's called model harmonization. So if you were flying Sully's US Airways flight, he had been doing this for a couple years in aircrew training inside the cockpit. Everybody had the same mental model of what happens when bad things go wrong on a commercial airline flight. That's why they survived. That's one of the reasons they survived. But he was able to build this common mental model and then share it with the rest of the crew. And they formalized that training. So what I do in the course of a semester is I show students. I say, hey, this is where you are today. 15 weeks later, using a very simple diagram, we're going to take all of that chaotic information and map it into this compass. So this is a cognitive model if you've never seen one of these. We just have to fill all this stuff in. When the students fill it in, it looks like this. And these are extremely valuable artifacts because we can now prove that if you teach students how to think, they can actually spend the time over 15 weeks changing the way they conceptualize concepts, relationships, semantics, interfaces, values. So there's a language that goes along with this. But let me give you a quick hint. There's very little research done in this field, but the field we're talking about is the field of visual language theory. We have lots of theories about linguistic language. You and I are talking about visual language. We are talking about how the brain processes visual information, both in the conscious and the unconscious realm. So when you leave here, the first thing to do is just engage with triangles, squares, and circles and realize out of that, you have to get the students to share that information so they embrace diversity of living, learning, their view of the world. They go, wow, this is totally different, Art. This is like something I've never heard about. But it works. I get it. Viscerally, they go, wow, my unconscious brain is engaging with this concept. And you got them off and running. Then you want to unify those disparate models over the semester into a unified model of what Chinese history is about, what international affairs is about, what microeconomics is about. We do that in physics. We don't do that in any other discipline in a university setting. I can walk into every department in this university and say, hey, could you show me your control vocabulary? Do you have a concept inventory you use that students are expected to know? Geez, what's the concept of a CPU? What's the concept of the internet? What's the concept of Internet of Things? What's the concept of big data? We so quickly want to throw out terms without defining them that for the rest of the semester, the students just struggle with, I'm not sure I'm getting this. Because we have not created the conceptual space that they need. And many of them take this chaos into adulthood. They get professional degrees. And they take this confusion into our workplaces. That's why companies are saying, we're not getting critical thinkers out of the university. What's going on, guys? Why aren't the students coming? But of course, they don't know the right questions to ask. You can't go get Myers-Briggs and give them a test for visual learning. So instead of making machines smarter, we should be making humans smarter. But this is a zero-sum game. In the economics field, if you hear about carving out the middle, it's because people in my field are continuing to accelerate the development of AI, of Internet of Things, of unmanned vehicles, which if we continue to let it progress at the speed that it's happening, we're going to send waves of college graduates into a social world where there are no jobs for them. Because scientists like me are building machines to take those jobs away. So that's what we call in the economics field carving out the middle. So you're only going to have PhD cognitive scientists, and you're only hopefully going to have the $7 an hour person working under a living wage at McDonald's while people come on their time off. So hopefully you have no questions, which I would appreciate. And I've thrown a lot of information at you, but I will certainly make sure that this stuff is posted up where it should be. Thanks for coming, guys. I appreciate it.